we can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pulifido. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are placing star 82 in front of the call-in number, lower the volume on your TV or your computer if you're calling in, and please listen to the phone and not the TV or computer because we are on an 8-second delay. So while I'm speaking here, and if you're watching the TV, we're going to hang up because you're not responding. And also, if you like, you can give your first name and the location where you're calling from. So tonight, as you see, I have a guest in the studio where we are proceeding on our series about domestic violence, domestic abuse, bullying. So I have in the studio tonight Lizzie Alessia.
Very nice to meet you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
She's also affiliated with Fearless Females. As you know, Bianca Dimitri was here in September. And so I think it's really important, Lizzie, that people listen to stories, victim stories, what happened to them. Because, you know, I think it's so important to identify with it and say, you know, this could be me. And correct. I think that's why we need to do this, is because people have to hear it. And we have to send the message, even for the people who don't understand. But we can get into that later.
Yes.
So I think a great way to start is, I guess you want to just tell a little bit about yourself and your story.
My name is Lizzie Alessia. I'm a resident from Staten Island for the past 20 years. And I am recently divorced out of a 16-year marriage, which was emotionally, physically, mentally abusive towards me and my children. He is the father of my children, of course, so we can't neglect that point. But after I got married, the abuse just started getting evidently worse. You know, it was verbally like, at first.
Right, but it was love, right? You really loved your husband.
I mean,
you thought everything was great.
Yeah, I mean, you learn to look past all the negative, especially when you have a family and you have children. There's children involved. It's not like a 1-2. I could just walk out the door. It's a lot of risk involved, and the good, you know, but my whole motto is when the bad outweighs, you know, if there's a lot of bad and the bad outweighs the good, then it's not worth staying in the relationship. But I think I stayed a little too long.
Right, because, you know, a lot of people say that, you know, you have to stay together for the good of the children.
That is true, but then when the abuse starts affecting the children in the process, then it's not good to stay. And, you know, I said that in the beginning. It's the children. It's the father of my kids. And personally, you know, I was raised without a dad. So I wanted to give my children that aspect of having a family and growing up in a household, you know. But it was very dysfunctional. And the arguments, you know, it was more arguing every other day and then every day. And so it's...
Right. So basically, people who say you have to stay for the children, that's kind of like, hey... You know, if it's an unhappy place to be,
if you're unhappy, if you're unhappy, your children are eventually going to be unhappy.
Right.
You know, follows the loophole. Okay. You know.
So let's start from the beginning. How did things creep up? Because most of the times when I talk to people, they don't even realize that they're on the road to being a victim.
That is true. That, you know, the whole first step is the denial process. You know, when you're with someone, you love that person, so it's, you know, you always have this hope and this stability in your mind that the person's gonna change. And, okay, we're arguing today, tomorrow will be a better day. And that was just, like, my remedy for so many years, and so it got really, really bad, and I just couldn't take it anymore, so.
How long were you in that relationship?
Well, I was with him for 16 years, since I was 18.
16, all right.
Yeah, I was married for about 10, but I was with him like six, a little over six before we got married.
Okay, so within all those years, when did you finally say enough was enough? Is it at the 16th year or?
Yeah, pretty much. It was 2007. I was enrolled into College of Staten Island. I felt, with all the verbal abuse and everything, I felt that I needed to do something with my life. So I started educating myself. I took a medical assistant training for a year, started working, and then I went on to attend my my college degree. And as I was educating myself, the abuse just got worse. I feel that he felt I was trying to become better than him. And, you know, he's Hispanic, not to critique Hispanic men or anything, mm-hmm. and not to, you know, be negative or judgmental on anyone. But I feel that this is a personal opinion that Hispanic men tend to have that macho ego attitude.
Okay.
So.
Was he from Staten Island too?
He was from Staten Island. I met him on Staten Island.
Because I don't want to.
Like
Staten
I said,
it's a place in its own
personal
too.
Opinion. It's not, you know.
You know, so not to veer off topic, because you got Grimm, a representative from Staten Island, and here he is threatening somebody, bullying him. But I'm getting off topic now. But just to go on. So basically, around 2007 was when you went to school and stuff, or
Well, I enrolled into CSI in 2004. Mm-hmm. My goal was to go and become a registered nurse. But I had to switch my major because I had to continue to work full time. So it was not doable at the time. Mm-hmm. So I switched and I got a sociology major instead. And it was like maybe my third year in college. One day I just came home and I just kind of like just told them I wanted a divorce. And
wow.
Yeah, I was holding it in for so long and I was so scared and I got tired of living in fear. I got tired of being controlled.
So what do you used to do for these years? Just try to control you, make believe that, to doubt yourself about your capabilities?
It's more of like the low self-esteem. He started to make me believe that I couldn't do good in my life, and it was more of like controlling at first. With the controlling comes the verbal abuse and the profanity and the cursing and calling a person out of name and all of that.
And a lot of this in public too, or just behind
the scenes? Oh yeah. Sometimes he was a drinker, so if he, you know, I never knew if it was a bad drunk or a good drunk, and you know, I always prayed that, you know, he wasn't going to do anything violent, especially outside. But everyone that knew him as a respectable person. So they didn't know that all this was going on in the house. They were like, you know, they saw him. They were like, oh, you know, he was always the one helping the elderly out and shoveling the snow out of the cars and helping the little, you know, people with their groceries. So no one knew that I was being abused, and I kept it quiet too.
Yeah, but if you were together somewhere, would he act the same way? Would he help people, or?
Well, he had this look that he would give.
Give it to?
And to me. Like if I did something that was out of place, or if I said something that I shouldn't have said, he had like this mean look, and that look was like, okay, don't overstep your boundaries type look, you know. So, and then he would wait till we got home, and then the argument would continue.
And for as long as it took until he got his point, or?
Yeah, and or I would just shut myself in the bathroom or go in the room and lay down with the kids and kind of like try to air him out and, you know, just let him calm down. And you know, I'm kind of a tough cookie too, so the arguments would, I would argue with him. So it wasn't like, I was trying to avoid it, but at the same time, I was trying to defend myself.
Okay.
So in 2007, when I came home from classes one night, and it was just a really bad day, and the kids were already in bed, and we started arguing like the minute I walked in. So,
but how would the argument be about? Would it be something really important, or would it be a little thing that nobody would argue about?
Like for instance, like I'll be in class and he'll be like, "No, you weren't in school. I called your phone. Why you didn't pick up?" Or you know, like little silly things, okay. Like or like why you wearing that? You know, and I had a bartending job, and you know, when you bartend, you tend to dress a little sexier to make a little more money. Not that you're cheating on your significant other, but it comes with the job. And, oh, man, there were so many nights that he would just call me and I had to come right back home from, you know, from work because he was the jealousy and, you know, the rage and all that stuff was there.
Okay, so. But before 2007, because I'm really surprised that you got enough courage to even go to school.
Yeah.
How did you, were you talking to anybody? How did you pull yourself?
Well, when I did my medical assistant training and I started working in the clinical field, I kind of enjoyed it. And, you know, the opportunity to help others and steer away from my problems was kind of my do thing at the time. And that's how I kind of avoided the whole marriage. I wouldn't say the whole marriage. I mean, I would say that I am a good mother and I was a good wife and I tried my best to my capabilities to hold on. And mm-hmm. I think 16 years is a very long time to hold on to
that. And, you know, I believe we have a caller on the phone.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Hello. You're on Decent Life. Hello.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Who's this? Decent Life?
Okay, thanks for calling in, sir. Good night.
Okay. Interesting.
I think he was going to get into the bullying process.
Yeah, probably.
This guy.
Maybe.
You know, because when you call and you say, this is Decent Life, hopefully you know where you're calling. But anyway, let's go. I mean, did you seek out help along this way, or did you just do it on your own? I mean,
I pretty much did it on my own.
Wow.
Did you have support from
friends, family? I mean,
from friends. You know, I had a lot of friends that I would talk to, and they would say, you know, you got to get out. And I would say, no, the kids, once again, that sour subject on the children, you know. So, I mean, it's like I said before, it was the whole denial process. Like, I couldn't do this.
Well, let's try one more time. And hello, you're on Decent Life. Hello.
Yeah, hello. How are you doing?
Fine. What's up?
Just want to ask the lady how she met the guy.
How did
I
meet
him? My name
is Rob. Hi, nice to meet you.
How did that work out?
You want to know how I met him?
Nice to meet you.
Okay.
Is that the question?
I don't know. Can we just have a good night, sir? Okay. So basically, I think he come across good on camera. That's what I think.
Okay, maybe. I hope so.
So, anyway, right. So, let's just go back to it. You met the person, and then it started to escalate.
Mm-hmm.
And during that time, did you actually see it, or did it take when you wanted to get out that this was wrong? But during the time, were you making excuses? How did you?
I was making excuses because I was in fear. Like, it was always, if you leave me, I'm going to take the kids, I'm going to try to kill you, I'm going to do something, you know. So it was pretty much out of fear. And that's why I think I went to school, to try to block out the fear and educate myself and have strength and the ability to speak out and let people know that this is wrong. Yeah.
What weren't you featured in the Staten Island Advance?
Yes.
Back in 2008?
Yes.
And it's up on the screen. It says, Staten Island woman defeats domestic violence with a message of hope.
Yes, that's me.
That's you. So what were you conveying to other domestic violence? Is this the Turn Back the Night thing that was happening? Or?
Well, when that article was printed, that was when I first started to speak out about the abuse, mm-hmm. and that was when I joined the Bertha Center in College of Staten Island, and I became like part of the women's group, and I met up with Bianca and everything. So meeting different people and that also went through a little bit of what I went through, or mm-hmm. even shared some of the similarities that I went through, kind of gave me the strength. So, you know, so one day I'm sitting at home and, you know, a reporter calls me and he's like, I want to do an article on you. I mean, when in 2007, when everything happened, I mean, it hit the paper. It was so big. Like, my ex-husband, like, stabbed himself.
Okay, let's get to that story. Okay, let's tell us what happened. That did hit the newspaper.
Well, that night when I came home and I asked for a divorce, and he didn't take it so well, so he kind of barricaded me and the children in the home, and I couldn't get out. He broke all the phones, and yeah, my oldest son had also got involved, and I had to lock him in a room to keep him safe. So it was like a big ordeal. And
so he was on the rampage.
Yeah, he went on a complete rampage. It was like a completely different person, and he was like, you're not leaving anywhere, and I, you know, he's like, if I can't have you, then no one will, you know, like the typical domestic person would say. Yeah. And he said, you know, I'm gonna stab you. And you know, at that point, I was still trying to defuse the situation. I'm like, listen, whatever you want, we'll talk about this tomorrow, you know. And mm-hmm. I'm like, it's late, I just got home from school, you know. So, and he just kept going on and
so
on.
So did the cops show up later?
Well, yeah, because he, you know, after he said that, he kind of turned the tables around and was like, well, I'm just going to stab myself, and I'm just going to say that you did it, and you're going to lose everything, you know. And
I'm smiling, but it's amazing,
you know,
what people
and
say.
I was in shock. Wow. I was like, you wouldn't do that. And he's like, yeah, the F I would. And he did. He took out a pocket knife, and he punctured his small intestine.
Really?
Damaging his small intestine, where he needed a colostomy bag. And, you know, it was just like the weirdest thing, because when he did that and he started screaming to my daughter, mommy stabbed me, and you know, I'm looking at him like, no, you're not doing this. Like, I'm like, you're completely
wow.
insane. You know, when he did that, my immediate thought was like, if a person could harm themselves, then this man will kill me.
Yeah.
You know, if he can actually do that, that's what woke me up. You know, that's when I said, oh no, I can't do this no more. Because so many times we've broken up and I've always taken him back, because it was always the sorries, I won't do it again, you know.
So that's what I heard is another cycle is
yeah,
that they always come back on their hands, you know, and their knees.
The sorries, if I had a nickel for every sorry, I'll be rich. I'm serious, because, you know, and I always kept them back. But that night, I wasn't going back. And, you know, he politely just took off his bloody t-shirt, packed up his bags, and I'm still trying to get out the house. I think at that point my son had hit him and he fell to the floor, and he was barricaded by my front door. And we're talking about a 6'3", 250-pound guy, and
wow.
I'm like 5'3", 140 pounds. Like, you know, so we're trying to pull him away from the door. And I finally got the door open, and my daughter, you know, in the back of my mind, all I could hear is my daughter screaming, my shoe, my shoe. That's all my daughter was worried about, was her shoe, because she was barefoot. You know, I had woken
her
up.
In shock, because she didn't know.
I just wanted to get out the house.
Yeah.
Like, everything was happening so fast. So I remember, like, running out of the building, and some lady was talking to someone on her cell phone, and I just grabbed the phone off her hand, and I was like, I have to call 911.
Yeah.
You know, my husband just stabbed himself, and she couldn't believe me. And at the point, someone else must have called the police at the time, because as I'm speaking to the operator, the police are already pulling up. And they're like, okay, ma'am, hang up the phone. And then you see my ex-husband walking out the building like nothing happened.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's just drops his bag, lights up a cigarette, then he tells the officers that he has a gun. So now I have like 10 cop cars swarming the street, like ready to shoot this man. And I'm in the ambulance getting treated for cuts and bruises, and I'm still trying to defend him. And I'm still trying to say, no, he doesn't have a gun. No, don't shoot him.
Instead of telling him, lock
so
him
it's
up,
like, I just
jail,
got, like,
right?
Exactly.
And you still feel something for him.
And, I mean, I just didn't want him to get hurt. I didn't want them to kill him, you know. I'm like, no, he doesn't have a gun. He's lying.
Well, since you didn't kill him.
Exactly.
Well, like, the cops didn't anyway.
Exactly.
Where is he today, and how's the relationship right now? Is it just...
It took me some time to, you know, kind of like follow up with him because of my daughter and my son. I to speak to him. We are on good terms. You know, I let him know you're not in my life anymore. You can't control me anymore. So it's either you with your children or nothing at all, right. You know.
Is he with anyone else now?
I don't think he's in a relationship. I think separating from me took a big toll on him once he accepted the fact of everything that he did.
So he did go for help. Is that what you're saying?
I don't think he went to therapy, you know, but I think after some time, you know, he probably woke up and said, okay. Hey, this is what I did.
Like, I think we have another call coming in.
Oh, I hope it's a caller this time. And
hello, you're on Decent Life. Hello. Yes? I can't hear you too well. Okay, I think we have a bad connection. All right, so we're getting kind of like to the end of the show.
Wow, see how fast that went.
Yeah, so from your experiences, what would you tell somebody now who's thinking that, well, maybe I'm in an abusive relationship? What would you say to them?
Well, the first thing.
What was the sign? What was the thing that
I mean
that got you to
the first minute? You know, you're with someone and they tell you, I don't like that shirt, take it off. That should be your sign not to even bother, you know. I mean, and
right. Don't, even you though know, you love them so much, don't, whoever, a man, I mean, or woman.
Listen, if love can go to the end of the moon and yeah. back, but there's not that much love in the world for a person to be abused. And it's not only for women. I sit here solely speaking about women, men, straight men, heterosexual, gay, like it doesn't matter. Like if you love someone, you're willing to give that person the world. Love is not supposed to hurt.
That's right.
Love is supposed to be good. You're supposed to be in love. You know, I look at the elderly couples that have been in relationships for like 50, 60 years. I'm like, how the heck did you do it?
Cause right. But they do have arguments, but it's not to where it's controlling, manipulating.
But they're probably not abusive. And maybe if they are, the person doesn't want to come out and speak about it. It has to take the person themselves. They have to make that first initial step. I mean, I can speak to people until I'm blue in the face.
Okay, we have one more call. Let's see if we can get it. Hello? Yes? I guess we could hang up on that one. Yes?
Yeah, my name is Ralph.
Hey, Ralph.
Yeah, the reason I'm calling is I'm going through a lot with a young lady.
Okay. Hello?
She's disabled, and she's just, I'm, you know, every time I turn around, she's constantly yelling at me, and, you know, I don't know what to do.
Well, I mean, do you love her? How long you guys been together?
We've been together about 5 years.
Okay, I mean,
I think the first step is you need, since you think there's a problem, you need to seek out a therapist, someone who can facilitate and help you with
well,
this.
Well, he's making the first initial step now by admitting it.
Yes.
Because that's the first initial step, by admitting that there is a problem.
I had done that, but I'm just getting, I'm nowhere.
I mean, is she physically abusive or verbally abusive or both? Ralph, are you still with us?
Actually, she's going through a lot. Yes, I am. I'm here.
Yeah, but Ralph, what you're saying
maybe
is
maybe she should
even if she's disabled or whatever, she's pulling on your heartstrings, yes. And she's controlling you, and you need to get out of the situation. Even for a while, but the main thing is there's a lot of hotlines. You could go to the hotline.org, and even if you want, go to the fearlessfemales.org website.
Right, which is our website.
The main thing is you need the help. You need to pursue this. Okay, Ralph? Good luck to you. Hello, Young Decent Life. Hello?
Oh, I don't hear him.
I don't. You have to call back. We don't. We can't make it. We're having trouble with the telephone. Okay, have a good night. All right, so we're going
to... Well, for the callers, for the callers that are trying to get through, I have an email, you know.
Okay.
If they want, they could email me. I always, frankly, look at my email.
Yeah, please give it.
It's Laricia. It's Laricia 2002@yahoo.com. And there's also fearlessfemales.org. You could go on the website also and leave a message for either me or Bianca, and we promise to get back to you.
And it's not just for females.
It's for men also.
All right.
It's for, you know.
Right. So one of the things I suggested with the word females, F-E in a different color or males in a different color.
Right.
To emphasize that.
Well, we
it's
don't, I
way.
Mean, I'm kind of glad that the gentleman that just called, uh-huh. I mean, we don't really have a lot of men that actually come out
and admit
to this. I mean, it, you know, domestic violence is a strong topic. And when it comes to the political aspect of things, no one really wants to get involved. That's why I did everything on my own.
Right, because law enforcement, the courts...
Because they, you know, I mean, a situation with me, 16 years, they're like, oh, you're just going to go back with him. Why should we help you? That's their input on things.
Right.
A lot of these women that are abused go back. And that's what I did.
Right.
And that's what I don't recommend.
Well, the thing is, too, when I talk to some of these hotlines, it is a person will go back 9 times.
Correct.
Before they out of the situation.
Oh, yeah.
And we're going to need to start to wrap up. And I know we have another call, but I'm sorry we can't take it because we're almost out of time. So
you can email me.
Email her again. Say it one more time.
It's Laricia. That's Laris as in Sam, EA 2002@yahoo.com or fearlessfemales.org.
Fearlessfemales@gmail.com?
And that's another one,
okay.
@gmail.com.
Okay.
So we have two of them.
With organizations like Fearless Females and people like you standing up,
correct.
We can stop the rain.
I wish we could.
Yeah.
I really wish.
But you know what? All we need is love. Good night. Good night, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you
for having me. It was great.
Okay.